Well, good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's good to be here this morning with you.
Good to have you.
How's everything going so far this week? Yeah? Okay. All right. Well, we are in the second letter of Paul to the Corinthian church, and we are looking at chapter 1. And we kind of have made it pretty much through verse 7 for the most part. So we're going to kind of go through the first chapter. You guys have any prayer requests or anything like that?
You're the boss.
I'm not the boss. Jesus is the boss. That's actually what we're learning about here.
Yeah.
Yeah? So, let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we come before you, Lord, in Jesus' name, and we ask you, God, to have mercy on us for our many sins, Lord. Lord, we know that we have done things and thought things and spoken things that were not honoring to you, Lord. And we just ask, God, that you would have mercy on us and that you would lead us and guide us in paths of righteousness for thy name's sake. Father, we ask as we open our hearts to be ministered to by your word and your spirit. Father, that you would, Lord, that you would reveal those things that are helpful for the building up of your body here at the Ekklesia, or the church here at Brookdale, as well as myself and Brenda. Lord, I pray that you would bless us, and Lord, that you would fill us afresh with your Holy Spirit. I pray for all of those moms who are present here, Lord, that you would bless them. As we move into Mother's Day and we celebrate what it is to actually bring life into the world and to care for that life and to nourish it and to watch our children grow, and we just give you thanks, Father, for our moms, for the women in our lives who have been a blessing to us, and God, we just thank you so much, God, for loving us, and we ask you to reveal something to us today. Build us up in the Spirit. Lord, renew our souls, refresh us. And God, we will glorify you with all that we are, because all glory goes to you, Father. You are the creator of the heavens and the earth and all that is in them. So receive this offering of praise through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And Paul, an apostle of King Jesus through God's will, and Timothy, our brother, to God's assembly in Corinth, with all God's people in the whole of Achaia, grace and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord King Jesus. Let us bless God, the Father of our Lord King Jesus. He is the Father of mercies and the God of all comfort. He comforts us in all of our troubles, so that we can then comfort people in every kind of trouble through the comfort with which God comforts us. Just as we have an overflowing share of the Messiah's suffering, you see, so we have an overflowing share in comfort through the Messiah. If we are troubled, it's for the sake of your comfort and salvation, and if we are comforted, it's for your comfort, which comes about as you bear patiently with the same sufferings that we are going through. And our hope about you remains firm, because we know that just as you have shared in our sufferings, so you will also share in our comfort. You see, my dear family, we don't want to keep you in the dark about the suffering we went through in Asia. The load we had to carry was far too heavy for us, and it got to the point where we gave up on life itself. Yes, deep inside ourselves, we received the death sentence. This was to stop us relying on ourselves and to make us rely on the God who raises the dead. He rescued us from such a great and deadly peril, and he'll do it again. We have placed our hope in him that he'll do it again. But you must cooperate with us through prayer for us, so that when God gives us this gift, answering the prayers of so many, all the more we'll give thanks because of what's happened to us. This is what we boast of, you see. This is what our conscience is telling us, that our conduct in the world, and in particular in relation to you, has been marked by holiness and godly sincerity, not in merely human wisdom, but in God's grace. We are not writing anything to you after all, except that you can read and understand. And I hope that you will go on understanding right through to the end. Just as you have understood us already, well, partly at least, we are your pride and joy, just as you are ours. On the day of our Lord Jesus. I was quite sure of this, that's why I wanted to come to you again, so that you could have a double blessing. I intended to go on to Macedonia by way of you, and to come back to you from Macedonia and have you send me on to Judea. Was I just fooling around when I was making plans like this? Was I concocting schemes in a merely human way, prepared to say yes, yes, and no, no at the same moment? God can bear me faithful witness that our word to you was not a mixture of yes and no. The Son of God, Jesus, the Messiah, who was proclaimed among you by Silvanus, Timothy, and myself, wasn't a yes and no person. In him, it's always yes. All God's promises, you see, find their yes in him. That's why we say the yes or the amen through him when we pray to God and give him glory. It's God who strengthens us with you into the Messiah, the Anointed One. And he has anointed us too. God has stamped a seal on us, giving us the Spirit in our hearts as a first payment and a guarantee of what is to come. For my own part, I call on God as witness against my own life that the reason I haven't yet come back to Corinth is because I wanted to spare you. This isn't because I'm making myself the Lord and Master over your faith. Your faith is the reason you stand fast. Rather, it's because we are cooperating with you for your joy. This is the word of the Lord. Holy is the Lamb. So we kind of finished up last week and we were talking about this idea of how the justice of God kind of works and how an apostle will take the suffering of the community onto himself and basically draw the fire to himself so that they can have a better time of it as they're growing in their faith, much more so earlier on in their faith than later on in their faith, right? That's why it says that if you have someone among you who's falling into sin, you want to restore them with a spirit of gentleness. So being willing to take some of that burden from them as they're being restored to a place of right standing with God, as they're getting right with God, so to speak. Okay? But then we're going into this absolutely unbearable suffering that Paul starts going through as he's visiting these different churches, and he's so eager to proclaim the gospel and to celebrate this new life that we have in Christ, but he starts to actually work from his own flesh, out of his own strength, and he doesn't want to make plans where he's yes, yes. He wants to seek the Lord's will in everything that he does. But yet there's this just desire to kind of take the burden so much on himself that it's more than even the Lord is asking him to do. Does that make sense? You ever get so zealous for something that you just start going after it with your full force and you start to kind of stumble in it a little bit? Does that make sense? And so that's what's happening. And see how he addresses them. He says, "You see, my dear family, we don't want to keep you in the dark about the suffering we went through in Asia." So Paul is over in Asia, and he's going through all this suffering, and he's struggling with all these things, and he's got things going on internally, and he's got things going on externally, and he says it's not just him. He says, "Keep you in the dark about the suffering we went through." So the people that were with him were going through the same suffering that he was experiencing. And so why were they suffering? That's the question we often ask, isn't it? If we're going through a rough spot in our lives and we're Christians, we're like, "Lord, what are you doing? What is going on? I don't understand this. This doesn't make sense to me." And so in this sense, what he's doing is he's saying, "Listen, I've got this heavy load. We were in Asia. We're going through all this trouble. And I don't want you to be unaware of it." Why does he not want them to be unaware of it? How many times have you guys been going through some struggle in your life and like, "I really don't want to tell my kids about it because they're just going to worry and and da-da-da-da, so you kind of kept it in and didn't kind of let people know what was going on, and you just kind of silently suffered on your own. Anybody ever done that?
Sure.
Yeah. We're getting ready to sell Mother's Day. Moms do it all the time, don't they? But that's not healthy, is it? No. Paul says, "You see, my dear family, we don't want to keep you in the dark about the suffering that we went through in Asia. The load we had to carry was far too heavy for us. It got to the point where we gave up on life itself." Wow. Does Jesus ever want us to get to the point where we give up on life itself? That's kind of crazy, right? So what's going on with Paul? How did that happen? It seems like the Apostle Paul is still growing into his faith a little bit here, doesn't it? He got to the point where he gave up on life itself. Or they got to the point where they gave up on life itself. Deep inside themselves, they received the death sentence. Why? So that we would stop them relying on themselves and make them rely on the God who raises the dead. So, in other words, there's this promise in the scriptures that tell us that we can bring our burdens to the Lord and give them to Him, and He'll carry them because He loves us. But yet, we want to take so much on ourselves, right? I remember one time seeing my wife, she was kind of getting ready for work in the morning, and she always had all these bags of stuff that she had to take, you know, with her, like the laptop and this and her purse and all that stuff. And I just remember this one morning, you know, we hadn't been getting along very well, and I was like, babe, can I help you with some of that? She's like, no, I got it. And we do that with God all the time, don't we? We're like, then I got this. I know that you'll lift this burden off my shoulders. I know that you'll help me and all that stuff. But you know what? I got it, okay? I got it. We do that. Why do we do that? I don't know. Different reasons, I guess.
Stubborn.
Yes, deep in inside ourselves, we receive the death sentence. This was to stop us relying on ourselves and make us rely on the God who raises the dead. Make us rely on... Why does Paul put that there? All of a sudden there's this thing about the resurrection. Okay, God will lift my burdens and everything like this. Because if we're going to let God carry our burden, that means we have to die to ourselves. Right? I used to do the same thing all the time. I'd be run, always trying to help my mom and help my friends and help this and help that and take care of the house and do this. And rarely would stop and ask someone for help. And if someone asked me if I would do something for them, yeah, absolutely. Wouldn't look at a schedule or anything like that. Drove my wife nuts. Just so we already have stuff going on. Da, 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 da. Well, I told him I'm going to do this too, so let's figure out how to get it done. You know, and that was me not knowing that I was getting burdened. So then I asked myself, well, Lord, why did you have all this stuff going on? Why did you have all these people come to me and ask me for help and me have to say no to certain things? Because you were relying on your own strength. I wanted to show you to rely on me and help them to rely on me rather than to rely on you. Because you're just a man. And you can't handle it all. That's pretty amazing, right? That God loves us so much that sometimes He'll let us come to the point where we see our own failures so that we learn the lesson in a way that transforms our thinking, it transforms the way we see life, and pray God it transforms the way we live life going forward from that moment. That's called repentance, right? Conviction of the spirit that you're doing things in a wrong way, realizing that God has promised us something better, and then changing directions and walking in the spirit. That's good, right? Anybody ever experienced that? But what does he say? He says, "He rescued us from such a great and deadly peril. And he'll do it again. We have placed our hope in him that he'll do it again." So now Paul is saying, hey, listen, I'm not saying not to serve the Lord and not to go forth and preach the gospel. I'm not telling you should be afraid of going into those dark, scary places where people are sinning. But when you do that, remember, I'm always with you. The call is follow me, not lead me. Right? When Jesus calls a man, he doesn't say, come lead me. He says, follow me, right? And so he says, he rescued us from such a great and deadly peril, and he'll do it again. They placed our hope in him that he will do it again. So no matter what we come up against, as we go forth in the proclamation of the gospel and making disciples of all nations, teaching people to obey everything that the Lord has commanded us, that he's going to be with us. If we find ourselves ensnared in something or in trouble, he will deliver us. He will save us. He will get us through to the other side. We talked about this a little bit last week, didn't we? About when Jesus said, get in the boat, we're going to the other side. And they start freaking out when the storm comes, right? Did he say we're going to the other side? Okay, we're going to get there. We might go through some stuff to get there, but he said we're going there, so let's go. Right? No reason to freak out, right? But you must cooperate with us through prayer for us. Here's a stipulation. What's this all about? Everything that we do is to glorify God, isn't it? Isn't that why we're created to be a kingdom of priests? And isn't the job of a priesthood to gather up creation's praises and offer them to the God who is worthy, the one creator God? And then as a royal priesthood or a kingdom, that means kings, royalty, we are to receive from God and bring his glad, wise order into creation, right? So as a kingdom of priests, that's what we're to do. So this has something to do with cooperating with one another through prayer for us so that when God gives us this gift, that is answering their prayer, namely for boldness and open doors in the proclamation of the gospel, that God's kingdom would come on earth as it is in heaven, that they would be delivered from all evil, right? Isn't that, what is the prayer? Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. So this is the prayer we pray. So there's a prayer for deliverance in there. There's a prayer for sustenance, spiritual and otherwise. There's so much in that prayer, but mostly that our first and foremost, that our Father's name would be hallowed or honored or praised. That his kingdom, His righteous reign and his rule would come on earth as it is in heaven. Answering the prayers of so many, all the more will give thanks because of what's happened to us. Some of you guys were around when World War II was going on and some of the wars and things, and when stuff like that was going on and you were back home, you would kind of hear things maybe on the radio, or you would go into town to the local shop and you'd talk with the boys and see what was going on with the war and everything, or the ladies would be down at the hair parlor getting their hair done talking about, you know, their boys that were off fighting the good fight and all this stuff. And you were longing for the conflict to be over so that they could come home, right? So that, you know, there was a just cause, you were hoping that things would be set right, all the wickedness would be ended, and more than anything, that you would have your child or your husband back, right? Ultimately, that's what your heart wanted. You want evil dealt with, and you wanted your family back, right? And so this is what's going on here. They're fighting a spiritual war. This is the true Jews, the true Jerusalem, the true Israel, being sent out into the world, bringing God's kingdom through the proclamation of the gospel, through the discipleship of all nations, so that God's authority, God's power, God's loving, righteous reign would be realized on earth as it is in heaven. And so you have these churches that are planted all over the world who are celebrating the victories of this general, if you will, Paul the Apostle, who's out there with this ragtag group of people going into some of the most pagan, some of the most disgusting places ever in order to bring about God's righteous rule and reign on earth as it is in heaven. And so when you would get a report back that there was a church planted here or there was a church planted there and they are changing and radically loving one another and living their lives for the gospel, you would praise God because he had answered those prayers. Because this is about more than just getting our missionaries back home. This is about filling creation with the presence of the loving, kind, and gracious God, the one creator God through Jesus Christ our Lord. This is what we boast of, you see. This is what our conscience is telling us. That our conduct in the world, and in particular in relation to you, has been marked by holiness and godly sincerity, not in merely human wisdom, but in God's grace. We are not writing anything to you after all except what you can read and understand, and I hope you will go on understanding right through to the end. Just as you have understood us already, well, partly at least, we are your pride and joy, just as you are ours in the day of our Lord Jesus. Boast. This is what we boast of. Paul, you ever have one of those friends that you're so proud of, or someone does something, you're like, man, I'm so proud of so-and-so, I'm so proud of my son, or so proud of my daughter, I'm so proud of my dad, I'm so proud of my mom, because they accomplished something. What is Paul boasting about? This is what our conscience is telling us. That our conduct in the world, and in particularly in relation to you, has been marked by holiness and godly sincerity, not in merely human wisdom, but in God's grace. His boast is in the fact that God's grace is powerfully at work in him and through him and his associates as they are taking forth the gospel. Paul seems to think that that would not be as much the case if these Corinthians were not praying for them. Somehow the prayers of the saints increase the activity of God's grace, of angelic activity for the saints who are walking in the truth and taking forth gospel purposes, as the prayers of God's people go up specifically for them, in resulting in more and more thanksgiving to God. This is a spiritual dynamic that we need to be aware of and should inform our prayer lives. Not in merely human wisdom, but in God's grace. So Paul's not saying, listen, I was able to think through these things more clearly. I was able to think about this. He says, no, we were going through some weird stuff. I didn't understand it all, but somehow I was proclaiming this gospel thing that Jesus died for their sins in accordance with the scriptures. He was buried and God raised him from the dead. And I don't know what's happening, but these people who have been living their lives a certain way for 20, 30, 50, 80 years suddenly are turning from their pagan idolatry, are turning from their wickedness, turning from this slavery to sin, and they're actually living lives of love, self-sacrificing love for one another in a community. And they're celebrating the God of Israel, whom they simply blasphemed before. I don't understand how that happens. I don't know all the inner workings of God's grace, but this is what's going on, so rejoice. And that's basically what he's saying. You know, he's learning kind of some of the dynamics of it. He's learning how some of it works and stuff. But somehow there's this deep mystery of the simple proclamation of the gospel somehow, when it meets with faith, accomplishes radical transformation in the hearts and minds and lives of real people in real places, then, just as much as it does now, and is available to us. This same power is available to us now as we proclaim the gospel. Life-transforming power to actually see people genuinely care for one another, genuinely love one another, genuinely want to lay their lives down for one another in a way that honors God. We are not writing anything to you, after all, except what could be read and understood. And I hope you will go on understanding right through to the end, just as you have understood us already, well, partly at least. We know from the Apostle Peter that there were some teachings of Paul that people twisted to their own destruction. They would see Paul engaging in a certain type of activity or behavior and think that he was walking in the flesh. In actuality, he was walking in the Spirit, and somehow people were getting convicted of their sins, and they were turning to the living God. But he tries to write to us clearly what's going on. If we read the Old Testament, the gospel is veiled. It's there, but it's veiled. But if we read through the Old Testament, and we think on the Lord, somehow that veil is removed, and we can see Jesus all through the Old Testament. We can see Jesus in the sacrificial system and the specific things that God taught them to do that were just signposts or pointers to what he was going to do in and through Jesus, or even signposts to Jesus himself. They call those Christophanies. These almost seeming appearances of Christ even before he was manifest in the flesh and tabernacled in our midst, where we beheld his glory like that of an only begotten Son, full of grace and truth. And Paul wants them to go on understanding. Sometimes we hear something one time and we understand something, but the more we think on it or we hear it a couple more times, it continues to kind of open and grow and fill us. And this is the kingdom, right? It's like leaven that a woman took and hid in 3 measures of flour until the whole thing was leavened. Your soul, your spirit, your body, your mind, filled with Christ. As we receive the kingdom, that's why he says you've understood partly at least. So there's this, well, if I've only understood partly, I want to understand fully. I want to keep seeking the Lord. I want to diligently seek him. Why? Because he's a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Well, how does he reward us? Does he reward us with money and cars and a wonderful spouse and kids and a white picket fence? Maybe. Maybe he does. For some people it does, others maybe not. But one thing I know that he does reward us with, more of himself, and that's the best thing that you could get. Think about that. Think about someone you genuinely love, who you genuinely love spending time with. How much would you give to spend more time with that person? You can't buy that. But if you seek them, and they seek you. God's always seeking us, isn't he? Always wanting to make himself known to us, always wanting to love us, always wanting his name to be glorified. He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. We are your pride and joy, just as you are ours on the day of the Lord Jesus. There's going to be a day when the Lord completes the good work that he started in each and every one of us and as a community. There is a day coming when that will happen. We get, the more we seek him now, the more we get to enjoy him now. But there is coming a day when we will be one another's pride and joy, and we get to kind of practice that now, to celebrate that, Father, you are my pride and joy, and I am yours. When I see you grow in the faith, when I see your smile and I get a hug, it's a good thing for me. And I hope it's a good thing for you, because we have fellowship in the Spirit. And the same is true for all of us. We are one another's pride and joy as we see one another grow in the grace and knowledge of the Lord Jesus. Think about that. When you guys first had kids, if you had a child, how amazing was it to see them grow? And you first they're drinking some milk, and then they're... I remember loading my firstborn son up, and the first time we went to the beach and had him out on the longboard, and he had his little hat on to protect him from the sun. And, you know, he didn't know what was going on. He just was amazed by everything. But he was finally old enough we could get him out of the house and go do something with them. And it was amazing, you know? And when you see someone growing in their faith, it's like that. It's like you are our pride and joy, and we're yours because we're growing too. And we get to build one another up in the Spirit, and that's amazing. We get to encourage one another in the faith, and sometimes we don't do that so well. Sometimes we mess up and we stumble through this Christian life because we start doing things in our own flesh like we saw Paul do. Sometimes to the point where we feel like we've got the death sentence deep inside ourselves. That's a dark place to be. But if you find yourself in that place, God has delivered you before, and he will deliver you again. Amen? Amen. And so as we go forth this week, let us remember one another in prayer, more so than ever before. We are one another's pride and joy. Amen? Father, we thank you for your grace and for your mercy, and we ask you, God, to work in our lives this weekend, to have mercy on us, Lord. We need you, Lord Jesus. We need to know you more. We need to have more of you in our life so that we can know how to love one another in a way that's fruitful. God, we praise you and we thank you. We give you all the glory, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, guys. Well, have a lovely week, and we'll see you again next week, I guess. Okay? We are one another's pride and joy. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you.